So, good morning, everyone. Happy October 16th, which brings us to episode 127. Still hard to believe, but onward and upward. We are now firmly in the fourth quarter and starting to see this week is going to be about the metaverse, but interesting announcements, some of which are a surprise. Well, not many are a surprise to me. Trust me when I tell you this. There was one surprise, but outside of that, we will cover that. So for those seeing this for the very first time, this is something I do every Sunday. It reflects basically what I've done through most of my career, if not all of my career. It's talked about new technologies, what's coming, what do you need to be aware of, what am I thinking about, what am I seeing, what am I preparing for. If you go out to my YouTube channel, you will see it's youtube.com/keeppace. And if you click on playlists, you will see that there is a playlist here for, Digital Disruption Weekly Webinars. There it is. So if you click on view the full playlist, you will see that I'm still back on episode 117. So if you want to see the newer stuff, you actually have to slog through the Facebook page, which is facebook.com/keeppace, which is how you got here. And I really have to just get myself some time to just do the edits and the uploads. So it's there for the taking. Again, the only caveat is it does take some time. I wish there was the proverbial Staples easy button that you could press, but no such animal exists. So for those seeing this for the first time, probably on YouTube, there's a method to the madness, as it were. It's my weekly reading. Sometimes I'm attracted by the wow factor, as it were, but typically I'm looking for these thematic big picture things and or details that help fill in this big picture. So as we talk about Web 3.0 or blockchain or, you know, the metaverse or, you know, these things, any articles that help kind of fill in those blanks or give some vision going forward, that's what tends to make, what I talk about each week. So the first one, and again, this is kind of a metaverse week because there were a sequence of announcements and it was just so funny. It was kind of like watching a tennis match, you know. It was kind of the ball was hit here, then the ball was hit here, then the ball was hit here, then the ball was hit here. And as I go through this, I think you'll understand what I mean. So the first one that gave me the biggest chuckle, and again, I had seen this, I had been waiting for this. They were working on the next version of the Meta headset to be in VR. So this is the one with the goggles, the hand pieces, the one that kind of allows you to go into this other world. And the first thing I started laughing about is the price, where it was debuts Meta Quest Pro VR headset that will cost $1,500. Now, I already know this is absurd. This is ridiculous. And you're going to see how much more ridiculous it gets as I go through these subsequent articles. So Mark Zuckerberg said on Tuesday of this past week that his company's newest virtual headset will start shipping on October the 25th, which is 9 days from now. The new headset costs $1,100 more than Meta's Quest 2 headset and contains new technologies like an advanced mobile Snapdragon computer chip developed with Qualcomm that helps the device produce more advanced graphics. So this was on CNBC. You'll find it, you know, in numerous places. You know, that's the visualization of this thing. I think it works with glasses, so you don't have to take your glasses off. It says the new headset contains some mixed reality features that can blend elements of the virtual world with the physical world. Zuckerberg has touted that as an important feature because, again, we keep getting back to the virtual reality versus augmented reality. I'm in the augmented reality camp. I'm still not seeing the VR stuff. Now, there's another part to this that gets interesting really quickly. And again, I'm not sure what the best order to put all of these articles in. So let's kind of, I'm going to jump around just a little bit because I wasn't really clear as to how to best put all of this together. So then now already we know $1,500, and this is going to be, we've seen this before, by the way. If you're new to this space, If you go back, 3 years ago, 3 to 5, maybe even longer, 5 years ago, Google had Google Glasses, and they were at least touted, and I think it was a lot of their AR stuff, if I'm not mistaken, back in the day. Their glasses were about $1,000 as well. So if you think about just the basic economics of supply and demand, there's not a lot of demand, hence the price goes up. The problem is when the price is up, not many people are going to buy it unless it is amazing technology, right? So already we've got this the proverbial chicken and egg moment where there's only a subset of people that are going to go out and spend $1,500 on something, especially while you're building the thing that you need the $1,500 for. So to me, this is one of the many reasons why I have been skeptical of the metaverse, number one. Number two, these devices, and it was funny, I was having a conversation with somebody yesterday about this, that, you know, said when they've used this before, they actually get dizzy. If they're in that environment for a while, you know, the technology makes them dizzy. So this to me just seems like I'm very skeptical about this particular article. And you're going to see with all the reading I did this week, there's reason for the skepticism, and I'm still trying to figure out what this means on a go-forward basis. So that's the first one. We're going to keep referencing back to this 1500. So now, okay, so that was next one. Now, the next one was related to this. So let's just go back. Sorry. Please clap. Microsoft Teams meetings coming soon to a metaverse near you. So Microsoft and Meta, i.e. Facebook, have decided to bring a ton of Microsoft products into the metaverse, including Windows, Office, Xbox, and Teams. Now, in the article, Teams meetings are already obnoxious. You know what would make them better? Being forced to do your whole job in Teams with your boss's legless avatar, preferably while wearing a VR headset so you can't see your coffee mug. Now, lots of questions here. I mean, my God, I could probably spend 15 minutes just on this particular one itself. Now, this was on Extreme Tech. So first off, if I'm going to spend $1,500 on a headset, which I am not, if that is the visual that I'm going to see, I hate to tell this to you, but if you go to Second Life, which has been around since, the early 2000s, it's a hell of a lot better than this, number one. Now, number two, I get, and again, if you haven't experienced Second Life, first off, it's free. It doesn't really cost anything. You can actually go and experiment with this. There were numerous ideas that were captured back in this, during the Second Life era. So for example, Circuit City worked with IBM and they actually had a Circuit City store within Second Life. I think that was around the 2006 because Circuit City went out of business 2008. So around the 2005-06 timeframe, Circuit City actually had an environment where you could go, all the product information was there. It didn't necessarily have live people there all the time, but it set the stage for what a store might look like. Another thing that they had talked about were these, we'll call them private rooms. So if you can think about this for a second, you know, let's just say we were part of a team. Well, one of the things you could have done in Second Life was if you had access to a dedicated area, picture a meeting room that you've been in that's had whiteboards around the perimeter. Well, if we had a meeting, wrote on the whiteboard, and assuming nobody erased it, if we left the room and then came back at a later point in time, all of our information was still up on the wall. Well, Second Life and people that wrote these rooms for Second Life had that capability. So the structural concepts of this are not necessarily new. We've seen it before. Now, I get curious as to what, you know, if we think about, put the technology aside this second, just put the R&D budget together. I can understand why a company like Microsoft would want to play. They're like, look, maybe this is something out there. And Xbox is one of those entry points that we've talked about, right? Gamers being one of them. So I kind of get the Xbox angle. There may be a small uplift to bring the rest of the Microsoft products, such as Office or Teams, into the metaverse. So I get it from a R&D perspective. What I don't get, and this is the next version, so let me jump ahead again, because this week was, there's a lot of overlapping pieces. So I get this idea of Microsoft being able to go in and experiment on somebody's platform, because at the end of the day, there's an R&D write-off. You learn something along the way. I get that part of it. But you know, this one line in the article also where it says, Mike, you don't legitimize your terrible idea by forcing it on people really politely. Again, to me, a lot of this does feel forced. I don't think that we have found that killer app. I don't think that, I think it's a technology in search of an answer at the moment. I truly believe this, right? I have yet to find that business value. And it's not to say it's not there. Just haven't seen it in a way that's ubiquitous, number one, that has a low cost of entry, number two. This is still all kind of, for lack of a better term, my opinion, pie in the sky stuff. Now, let's go ahead to one more article. Again, I may come back to this. So this other article I found came out in August. I was surprised I hadn't seen this earlier. And it just talked about the 21 best metaverse platforms to watch in 2022. And again, there wasn't a whole lot here. It was just a list of these 21 virtual worlds. And I don't know if I included this particular article previously. If I did, it's just a good reminder. But what they have here is, here are the top 21. So instead of you as an individual trying to hunt all of these down, somebody did the work for you. So that's good, A. But if we look at this, first off, as I look in that list, don't see Meta anywhere, number one. I see UHive and Hypernation and Sandbox and Decentralized. Sorry, this is in a very light green. If you can't see it, it's not me. But what I would say is, going back to the Microsoft piece, there's no standards here. We've talked about this. There's no virtual world standards in terms of APIs and properties and monetary exchange and the like. So one of the other challenges here is that if Microsoft is teaming up with a metaverse provider, in this case, Facebook, Meta, becomes very interesting, because the only thing that you're really going to get out of that experience is, what should an experience look like? How do you start getting your team thinking about interacting in that world? Which, again, we've talked about this as well. You can't be a fast follower, because some of this requires you to immerse yourself in a world that changes how you think. So, you know, Meta could be experimental. You know, Facebook's popularity, if you read the, you know, the trade rags, you know, seemingly goes down. The younger generation is going to other platforms. So right now, none of this seems to fit nicely, or at least to me, none of this appears to be obvious as to what that end game needs to be. Facebook is still building Metaverse. I think I commented on a post yesterday somewhere. I said they should have just went out and bought Second Life, number one. Number two, the hardware is still too expensive, number two. Number three, we still don't have the killer app. It's not to dismiss VR in its entirety, but I think it's really still early to have this much hype on something that has that many questions. So that's my position. Now let's go further down the rat hole, as it were. This is where it really started getting interesting. So this was on CoinDesk, and I've seen a couple variations of this. So this one was great. It's lonely in the metaverse. Dapp Radar, which I guess is one of these sites that tries to figure out usage, suggests Decentraland, which is another of these virtual worlds, has 38 daily active users in a $1.3 billion ecosystem. Now, you don't need to be a math major, nor do you need to be a finance major to realize that if you, let's just even say, let's go further down. The platforms say these numbers don't tell the full story. And I've seen other ones where, I forget which article it was, that they think it's 8,000. I don't know if it was the Meta one, because that's coming next. So already we see a huge challenge where, if there's this investment, which I'm going to guess is in the hundreds of millions of dollars, right? There's a lot of work. There's a lot of experimentation that's going on. If you don't have that uptick early, If you're still out there trying to figure out how this works, you're going to run out of money. It's just a matter of when. So to see these data points now that say, you know, here's companies that can at least or have an R&D budget that it can afford to do this, that's kind of part one. Part two is, if you can't bring them back, right, who's your audience? Who are you going after? If are you going after people that can afford the headsets? Well, are they really going to come into your environment to do nothing? So again, to me, there is a lot of questions in this space, and it's way early in the process to say that the metaverse is going to be here within, pick your time period, you know, a year. I think the underlying principles of what does that digital economy look like? You know, what are the standards that should be in place? What's the monetary value? How do we handle the IP? I think some of that work continues because that's going to be long-lived. A lot of this other stuff, again, and we've seen this before, loads of companies are going to create their metaverses, and the reality of it is, due to finances, they're going to collapse down to a precious few. So we're seeing this is deja vu all over again. From my perspective, I've seen this before. I've seen this pattern before, where it's a new technology. Sometimes it's trying to find a home. Sometimes it takes years before it really becomes a thing. So that was the Coinbase. And again, there were numerous articles about this. I've seen different variations of this, but thematically, this is that's the message. In terms of the usage, doesn't seem to be there, or the stickiness, shall we say. Now, the next one gets back to Meta, and this is just as damning. And this was on a Business Insider, where it says most Metaverse users don't even make it a month. So, internal documents show Meta's Horizon Worlds platform is struggling to retain users. This is from Wall Street Journal. Those who can afford the $400 price tag, which is on the current model, report the Metaverse has glitchy features and empty worlds. Now, again, $400 to do something that's experimental, I think you know where that ends up. And it says most Metaverse users don't return to the Horizon Worlds platform after the first month. Well, boy, you want to talk about a problem. So let's go back to Meta, which reports, you know, quarterly numbers to Wall Street. We know that based on a lot of activities last year that this privacy model and advertising is hurting a lot of these social platforms, right? Because it's been about privacy acts and all this other stuff. So that's number one. Number two, there probably aren't any new hot platforms to go out and buy. So that's problem number two. And number three, if you're investing in something that has no business model, number one, and you can't even attract and retain the users, well, you would think that's a big red flag. Now, I've seen variations of this. I mean, my God, this whole week on Facebook, you know, they introduced a new... the funniest one, I think, was they introduced a new feature where you can actually see the avatar's legs. And I'm thinking to myself, well, Second Life had this back in 2005. You could fly to different worlds. You could accessorize your avatar. Your avatars actually had professional companies that would build you an avatar that looked like you. I mean, there was this whole ecosystem based on Second Life, which didn't require a headset. And oh, by the way, you can go to secondlife.com right now, get an account, and I mean, you download an app. But it's two-dimensional. It's not, you know, you don't have to have a headset. So to me, this whole idea of forcing the metaverse, I've seen this before, and it just doesn't make sense. But this to me is a screaming problem for Facebook, because you're spending a lot of money. Okay, you've partnered with Microsoft, but now you got to get people to use it. And, you know, we haven't even gotten into the, when we talk about ubiquitous, what are those hardware requirements going to look like? What are the bandwidth requirements going to look like? To me, the list of questions and the list of issues is huge. And that's why I don't see this coming anytime soon. But again, it was all of these articles were helping to paint that that reality or support what I've been saying, that I wasn't a big fan of the metaverse. Now, do I think AR is the answer? I absolutely do. I'm still a huge believer in AR. Even that has some challenges. So, and where am I? Okay. So then the last one I had this week, and this is just kind of keeping it on the old, you know, the metaverse topic. This isn't good either, right? Army soldier says using Microsoft's HoloLens augmented reality goggles could get them killed. So it says nearly four, and this was on extremetech.com. So it says nearly 4 years and $22 billion into Microsoft's development of HoloLens devices for the U.S. military, an Army tester is warning that actually using the augmented reality goggles could get soldiers killed. The Army began receiving shipments of the custom-made integrated visual augmentation systems in September. Now, if you think about this at a high level, this could be interesting because if you have augmented reality, you know, you've got these glasses on that are giving you some additional information. There's no communication, so it should be silent. You would be able to put different information, visual information out to a soldier. So thematically, I get the idea, but let's go a little further. Now it's looking like Microsoft's fears were well-founded. An Army report dictated to Business Insider reveals that further testing has uncovered glaring problems with Microsoft's current iteration. The devices apparently emit startling amounts of light for technology designed with the battlefield in mind, making the wearer visible to enemy forces from hundreds of meters away. Well, there you go. So even though you have a technology and the benefits are pretty obvious, right? Being able to get more information to an individual out in the field, be it, you know, military or not, is a good thing. But in a situation where you need the cover of darkness, well, surprise, we have a problem. And then on top of all of that, the goggles' physical body limits the wearer's peripheral visibility, which is this way, which is a problem. And then it's allegedly quite bulky and heavy, making it more difficult for soldiers to move as needed. So again, you know, if I had to put this to the side and kind of move a little bit to the right, years ago, and again, this is not new. This is, we've seen, and again, when I see these patterns, I know I've seen them, maybe not everybody else has. But if you think about products over time, think of a ladder. And what happens is, I'll take an operating system as an example. Once upon a time, we had proprietary operating systems. There was HP Linux, and IBM's was, how was their Linux product called? It was called, I forget IBM's proprietary Linux. But most vendors had a proprietary Unix implementation. And what happened over time was that when the operating system became a commodity, in essence, there became one version, and that ended up being Linux with a primary version as it was. Well, what happens is this happens to technology, is that there's this proprietary period. The proprietary period has whatever time period it has. You begin to get competition. And then at some point in time, that competition tends to spawn what we'll call commodity platforms. And what happens is the vendor has to take the next step up on the ladder. And if you think about it, there's no vendor that's investing anything into, well, they do from an open source perspective, but there's no vendor that's really, and maybe you could argue Microsoft, because there's two operating systems kind of out there, right, for desktop, right, which would be Windows and Linux. You could argue that there's a bit stuff with Chrome and that other stuff. But if we think about it, there's not a lot of vendors out there doing operating systems for obvious reasons. AIX, that was it, Bruce. Thank you. Couldn't remember it. So what happens is you will always watch vendors trying to move up the stack. And they move up the stack in very interesting ways. In fact, I was just looking at one, and I don't have the names this week. Even for something as simplistic as Microsoft that has OneNote as an example, or the Office, started to see these other competitors, and Microsoft is now, I think Loop is one of them, and I forget the other one, but they were actually seeing people or companies that were building these solutions that, you know, basically took the commodity nature of what existed and added new functionality. The idea here is that you can't stay stagnant. These companies need to put out more features or differentiation, which means the stuff that used to be really, you know, sexy or new has become expected. What's the next thing? This is the problem, in my view, with a lot of this metaverse stuff. It's a technology looking for a solution, number one. Sounds like a good idea, but nobody has yet figured out how to make this work. And oh, by the way, Second Life, which I'm actually surprised is still in business personally, but if Second Life has been around since 2005, all of these different entrants into this metaverse world, just I look at it with a raised eyebrow because I don't know what their business model is and I don't know where the money's coming from. And you have to make this ubiquitous. And there's nothing I'm seeing across the metaverse. Now, AR, I think, is going to be different. AR, I think, is going to have its own ecosystems. You may have a wearable or you're going to have something that needs to project the information on a glass, but you're interacting with the world as you know it. This VR, I can think of use cases, but I can't think of a mainstream use case, and I'll just leave it there. So that's what I had for this week, or at least this is how, you know, for those that had been following me, this is how my thinking, this is how my positions evolve. I take my history of what I've seen, and I've seen this pattern. You know, for those that don't know, early in my career, I was like in an R&D unit. I used to see these types of products come out, sign non-disclosures. I understood the thinking of how people were how these ecosystems evolved over time. I was able to kind of take it where it was, look where it went, look back. I've seen these patterns before. So there's nothing in the metaverse that I would say surprises me. In fact, a lot of the metaverse reminds me of the very early days of voice recognition, where this concept of speaker independence didn't exist, where it was proprietary hardware, where, again, I've seen this before. I've seen it in so many other ways. So from my perspective, it's still worth following. There's still things that will come out of this. It's just I wouldn't dedicate a large portion of time to the quote-unquote metaverse. I keep looking at it more from a, okay, where's a business value that can be extracted? Again, I think the digital currencies are going to be one. I'm still convinced on that. I'm still convinced on the blockchain stuff. I'm still convinced on the Web 3.0 stuff. That stuff I think is more real. This metaverse stuff, I'm still not sold. So that's what I had for this week. Thank you again, Bruce Ray AIX. My God, I haven't said AIX in so many years, I forgot all about it. But that's what I had for you guys this week. October, believe it or not, is half over, which I find that amazing. So we have two and a half months left in the remainder of the year. So I know I have some vacation days I'm going to be taking to really start sitting down and figuring out what I want to do for 2023. So that becomes a missive. Oh, wait, what happened here? Hold on a second. What did I do here? Oh, I zipped past my big picture. I'm sorry, I missed my big picture. So, you know, there's always stuff out there, right? And these new disruptive technologies are just loaded with risk. And again, to me, it's okay to follow it. It's okay to get a taste of it. But, you know, be wary of jumping in with both feet because some technologies, you know, aren't necessarily ready for prime time. So that's what I had for you guys this week. I hope you enjoy my insights on all of this. I find it fascinating. I almost feel like I'm reliving part of my childhood again as I see some of these things evolve because it's I kind of know where some of this ends up, and it's not it's not where some people would like it to be. So with that, I would tell you to get out, enjoy your Sunday. It looks like it's going to be good weather today until I think another front's coming in where it's going to be a messy Monday. So enjoy your week. And we will be back again to do it next week. So until then, everybody, take it easy, and I'll see you then. Bye.